the noise, pressing in to hear your voice. We are rising up and we're shaking off the dust.
Yeah, come on, shake it off, shake it off.
There's a stirring in the wells and our hearts are overwhelmed. Let revival come as we're shaking off the dust.
Come on, let's brag on them teams that you are good.
Where you been all my life? I've been waiting on you. Come on in here. We are in for some kind of a time tonight. And I know I'm usually not in here, but I asked specifically if I could be on this day. Hello, Elkhart, Indiana, that tremendous campus of World Harvest Church over there. Pastor Nate, Miss Carlin, and all the elders, we love you. We bless you in Jesus' name. Everybody watching online. I don't know if you're on Facebook. I don't know if you're on YouTube. I don't know if you're on Instagram. I don't know if you're at rodparsley.com or you're just outside the door listening real close. I'm so glad you're here, but listen, it's never been easier in the world to help us share the gospel around the world. How can you do that? Well, just hit that share button. Share with everybody. Who doesn't need to hear the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ on Good Friday? The day when we bow our heads, the day when we remember the ultimate sacrifice of God's only begotten Son on that angry, mean, biting beam called Calvary. Well, tonight, we've got a great, great service for you. We're going to have Holy Communion together. We're going to partake of the body and the blood of Jesus Christ in an act of unity with the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, in unity with one another that is unlike any other demonstration in God's Word. So get some elements. You know how to do that. Get yourself something representing His body, something representing His blood, and we'll be joining together in that great holy act of communing with God. You know, Jesus said, I pray that they will be in me and I will be in them, even as you, Father, are in me and I am in you. So that's what's going to transpire tonight supernaturally by the power of the Holy Spirit. Share. I'm not going to let you up. I'm not going to let up on it. Not going to let you out of it. Share. And by the way, let us know from where you're watching tonight. We just love to communicate with you. We have ministers of the gospel here right over in that other room, and they'll be communicating back and forth with you all service long. Now tonight, Good Friday, I have got a message for you. Love on open display. Never before, never since, has love been on such open display as it was that fateful Friday. So you want to get everybody you know, get the whole family in there. You should have already had your popcorn, but get ready. We're going to have a blessed time in the Lord. Now, you know that tomorrow is what I have always called in my preaching, Silent Saturday. A lot went on Silent Saturday. Then Easter Sunday morning, sometime before midnight, an angel said, Mary, go and tell. Right after midnight, the Son of God is risen. Hallelujah. Jesus, he's alive and well. So I'm going to be preaching a message entitled, Just 3 Days. Now, you can get to Columbus, Ohio or Elkhart, Indiana. I'd be getting there were I you. So you can get on an airplane. You still got time. You could drive. You know, 2/3 of America lives within 500 miles of this pulpit. So you can get here. Think about it. Being in that atmosphere in the presence of God. Harvest Music Live will be here. I'll be preaching. We have got 40,000 pounds of fresh food and poultry that we'll be giving away. And the kids are going to have the time of their life. I can't even begin to describe all they're going to experience, but they will have a great big tens of thousands of Easter eggs to go hunt, and they'll enjoy that. So I want you to go to World Harvest Church. Don't do that. Go to whc.life. You get all the announcements there. They want me to hurry up, but I'm going to be right out there on the other side in just a few moments, and service is going to begin, watch me now, in 90 seconds.
Because he loves you that much. Think about it, y'all. What amazing love he has for us. Scripture says no greater love than this. Are you grateful for it, church? Sounds good.
Set. I believe there is one salvation, one doorway that leads to life, one redemption, one confession. I believe in the name of Jesus Christ.
Any believers in the room tonight? Come on, lift up that sound. Declare this out with us. Here we go.
I believe in the crucifixion. By his blood I have been.
to him.
All praise to God the Father.
Sing it out, sing it out.
All praise to Christ the Son.
Yeah.
All praise to the Holy Spirit. Our God has overcome. The King who was and is and evermore will be. In Jesus' mighty name, I believe.
I believe in the hope.
I believe in the hope of heaven. He's preparing a place for me, far beyond what hearts imagine, ears have heard, or eyes have seen.
I believe
a day is coming.
He's returning. Grateful and not ashamed, sing this with us.
No, I'll never be ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. How could I ever walk away from the one who saved my life?
Sing it again.
No, I'll never be ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ.
The good news,
how could I ever walk away from the one.
Father, we thank you that you loved us so much. We're so grateful. Come on, can we lift hands all around the room and wherever you're joining us from in praise and thanksgiving for our mighty God who loves us so much. Everything changed on this side of the cross. We thank you, God. This is all of our story right here.
I was a leper outside the city. None would come close. You wouldn't let go. What worked back then will work again. I know the blood is still blood.
Thank you, Lord.
I had an issue. No one could help. I tried them all. My last try, I crawled. But what worked back then, listen, will work again. I know the blood is still the blood.
Oh, how precious.
And oh, how precious.
How beautiful. Lift it up, church.
This priceless love.
I've come to know.
Oh, yeah.
Thank you, Lord.
In the midst of
the hard times in life,
I know the blood
is still the blood.
Thank you, Lord.
I was just like Mary, labeled by shame. They called my wrong, but you called my name. And one word back then will work again. I know the blood is still the blood. Still the blood. Yes, it is. And oh, how precious. And oh, how beautiful. This priceless love. This priceless love. I've come to know. I've come to. This priceless love, I walk in daily and come to know. In the midst of the darkest storm, I'm so glad to have confidence to know. It's still the
together. Lift it up, church.
Come on, Elkhart.
Sing it out.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Let the world go redeemed.
delivering, still making wrong things right, still making a way, still making a way, still making a way, still making a way. Yeah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Come on, give me the part. It washes wisely.
It washes wisely.
I'm looking for a witness. Come on, send it up. Send it up. Send it up.
Show you that we think we're the friendliest church in town. We're going to put 2 minutes on the screen, and we're going to ask that you get out in the aisle, show yourself friendly, meet somebody new, and then perhaps a familiar face. Here we go. 2 minutes. Meet and greet. Let's go.
Bruised for our transgressions, wounded for our iniquities. By his stripes we are healed. We worship him today. His name is Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Welcome, welcome online family. We're so glad, and we pray and know that you're feeling the touch of the Almighty God right where you are right now in this place. So listen, don't just be watching. We want you to engage. We want you fully connected and engaged with what God is doing in this atmosphere. Let us know how the blood has touched you, how because of the blood of Jesus, you're a different person today. Listen, we want a fellowship as a body of believers right here today in this community. So go ahead and begin to testify in the chat and let the people know about the goodness of God. Listen, we have some people commenting already, letting us know how God has blessed them. We have Susan, we have John, we have Wesley watching from all over the world. We have people from North Carolina, from South Carolina, from Bermuda, from Nigeria. We have people from all over the world. We welcome you. So listen, as you're testifying in the chat, let us know where you're watching from, because we know that the blood of Jesus reaches all over the world. So we want to know how and where you're watching from today. So let us know all across the globe where you're watching from. And listen, we're so glad to have you here joining us and fellowshipping as we have our holy communion service, remembering and worshiping the Lord Jesus Christ. We're so thankful that you're here with us, and we pray that you'll stay with us even until Sunday as we celebrate the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. What a weekend. So listen, stay engaged, stay stirred up, stay locked in, because we're about to hear a word from heaven. And get ready right now, because we're about to go back and hear the word in service.
Amen, amen. Friendliest church in Columbus, indeed. It always takes us the longest to get y'all back to your seats, which we love, because it means you're out there meeting and greeting and fellowshipping as brothers and sisters in Christ should do. You may be seated once you find your seat. Happy Good Friday. Yeah, that's something worth celebrating. Amen. There's an old song that I've been reminded of today. On a hill far away stood an old rugged cross, the emblem of suffering and shame. And on that old cross, where the dearest and best for a world of lost sinners was slain. Sinners like me, sinners like you, sinners watching online. But thank God we were saved by grace because of that old rugged cross. It says, I'll cherish that old rugged cross. I'll cherish that old rugged cross. Pastor, you want to sing it? Till my trophies at last I lay down, I will cling to that old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. How many of you are glad for that blessed assurance that this life is but a vapor and we find eternal hope in our Savior and Lord Jesus Christ? Again, you can be seated. Of course, I'm Ashton Blair. I'm the first daughter here at World Harvest Church. And as I said, I'm the proud student pastor of Valor Christian College. But would you stand if you're able? It's always my honor and my privilege to introduce, as I always say, not just my biological father, but my spiritual father. And he has been locked away for weeks and weeks and weeks now in preparation for this resurrection weekend, for tonight's Holy Communion service, and for Easter Sunday morning. And it's been 50 years of gospel ministry that he is celebrating this year. And so we are honored to have him in his pulpit tonight, Dr. Rod Parsley.
Isn't she lovely? So lovely. So full of God. Look at that. Millennials can live for Jesus. Isn't that something? Amen. We love you so much. Let me say that I have taught tens of thousands of pastors across America and around the world to, of course, work hard on Easter, but work harder on the week after Easter. Because there are still too many folk that don't know what the church looks like without Easter lilies or Christmas poinsettias. And we need to let them know what it's like all the time, not just on Easter. So we work hard to give folks the opportunity to come back that next week. And when I began to see and research the sign in the sky that will take place across America on the 8th, the day after, the Sunday after Easter, which has not happened since, are you ready? 1776. Somebody that's at least got enough history left in your schooling to know what 1776 was. It was the birth of the nation of America, these United States of America. 7 years ago, say seven. Seven is the number of perfection. Seven is the number of completion. Now, anytime God gives a sign in the sun, that sign is for the nation. It's not for anything else. In the moon, the sign is for the body of Christ. In the stars, the sign is for the covenant participants of the kingdom of God. You'll find all three of those throughout the Bible. When God gives a sign in the sun, that's a sign for the nation. Now, I have told you before, it's not that God stopped speaking. It's that people stopped listening. The heavens declare his glory. Do you know that the Bible was in the stars before it was the spoken word that became the written word? The entirety of the Bible can be discerned in the stars. Now, I'm not talking about zodiacs. You know, zodiacs are like being drunk on alcohol is to being drunk in the Holy Ghost. It's a counterfeit. So you, people get all nervous, you know. You go to talking about the stars and the heavens. But the heavens declare his glory for the people who are observing, right? So 7 years ago, there was another eclipse. 7 years ago, hasn't been one since. 7 years ago, there was an eclipse that came across the United States this way. Are you with me? This way. It's called the Salem Eclipse. The reason it's called the Salem Eclipse is because it was a blackout across seven cities in America called Salem. Jerusalem. Peace. Are you listening? Seven cities called Salem. This one is not going this way. This one is coming this way. So they make an X across America 7 years apart. 7 years apart. Would you like to know where that X occurs? Little Egypt. A place called Little Egypt, directly across a road called Salem. This eclipse will enter the United States way down here in Texas. Do you remember? Now, leave that up there. Do you remember that God declared that it's an evil generation that seeks after a sign? Do you remember what he responded? I didn't think you did. He responded, there shall no sign be given except that, watch me, which was given to Jonah the prophet. Jonah. Jonah's message sent from God was what? Repent. Where did God send him? To Nineveh. Well, you got one of them. This thing enters the United States right over a place called, get ready, Jonah, Texas. It travels northward across Eagle Pass, Texas, which is in your news feed every single day. It actually enters where the last battle of the Civil War was fought. And it exits where the first battle was fought. This is a sign to the nation. This 2017 eclipse passed over seven cities called what? Salem, peace. This one passes over seven cities, including Ohio and Indiana, directly over seven cities called Nineveh. No sign but that sign which was given to Jonah the prophet. Jonah, Texas. Across Little Egypt. On across and exiting up into Canada, where it goes across another city, making eight, which is the number of new beginnings. Name Nineveh. And that's all I'm going to tell you. You have to come Sunday. I said you have to come Sunday. How many of you want to come Sunday? Well, how many of you are ready for a word tonight? Because I don't want to waste it. Everybody stand. Take in a great big deep breath of God's air. And let out a hallelujah that Jesus has never heard before. Now tell somebody next to you, get ready because it's about to get real good. And if you don't shout, I shout for you. Because shouting is the language of victory and silence is the language of defeat. Clapping is the language of authority. So if you got something that's been bugging you, clap your hands, oh ye people. Shout unto God with a voice of triumph. Let God arise and let his enemies be scattered. And every one of your enemies that rises against you one way, that Bible says will flee before you seven ways. Are you ready to run off every adversary? You may be seated. So I want to take a text. Sometimes preachers take a text and never do get back around to it. So let me get it. Now, if you're watching right now, and I know you are, by the hundreds of thousands around the world, I need you to go to whc.life before this night is over. And I need you to send me your prayer requests so that they can be on our resurrection altar. Now, don't send us a request that doesn't mean anything to you. God said, don't talk to me about stuff that doesn't mean anything to you. Talk to me about that stuff that makes you walk the floor at night. Talk to me about that stuff that's the first thing on your mind when you wake up in the morning and the last thing on your mind when you go to bed at night. So do that. Get those prayer requests here by Easter resurrection morning. And you can do that at whc.life. Are you ready? Galatians chapter 3 and verse 13 was one of the first scriptures that I memorized as a little tiny boy. It says this, Christ, the anointed one and his anointing. The anointing destroys every yoke. Christ has, past tense, anointed us. He has redeemed us, redeemed, to purchase back, you're not listening to me, by paying the sacrificial price. The propitiation, that's a great big fancy word. My daddy called that a $10 word. A propitiation. But it doesn't do any good for preachers to talk words that nobody understands. Propitiation means the price paid. And what a price it was. Your freedom and mine. Your eternal salvation and mine. Your health, wholeness, healing, spirit, soul, and body, and in everything that pertains to life and godliness was not free. That was a terrible, cataclysmic, awful, indescribable price to be paid. He did not come from heaven down, not deity humanized, nor humanity deified, and walk this earth for 33 and a half years, suffer under Pontius Pilate, be buried and left for dead, go into the darkened regions of Satan's underworld, and there grab the keys of death, hell, and the grave out of the unyielding hands of the Antichrist himself, lock them to the wheels of his chariot, and come riding back up out of there on his holy chariot, singing the very first chorus of free at last, free at last. Thank God Almighty, we're free at last. He did not do that without a price. Suffering, sighing, crying, dying, bleeding by which the very veins of God himself were emptied. Sinless blood, spotless blood, not blood like yours and mine, tainted with the awful curse of humanity's rebellion against God. No, sir, spotless blood. If you believe in a Christianity with no virgin birth, you have no Christianity at all. If you believe in a Christianity without the shedding of blood, I will simply take you to your Bible and mine in Hebrews chapter 9, verse 22, where God said, without stuttering, without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness of sin. Oh, the blood of Jesus. Oh, the blood of Jesus that washes white as snow. No other fount I know. Nothing but the blood. Nothing but the blood. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Not your religion, sir. To hell with your religion. Not your faux holiness, madam. Not your church-going millennial. Not your 30, 45 minutes of appeasement on Sunday morning somewhere. No, sir. Spotless blood. The life is in the blood. And without the blood, you have no life. You have an existence. You have a continual present, but you do not possess a future. Without the shedding of blood, not your good works, not your attempting with money to pay somebody out of a place called purgatory. No, sir, that's not what the book says. And the book is right, and they are wrong. And I need somebody that believes it to shout for 15 seconds, thank God for the blood. First Corinthians, I love this verse. I wrote a book from it. I've written 200, you know. First Corinthians chapter 1 and verse 23. I don't know about the church down the road. I don't know what they preach. But bishops, we preach Christ, and not just Christ, Christ crucified. Now it goes on and says, to the Jews. You could put in parentheses, because this is that to which he was addressing. He's saying to the Jews or to the religious order of the day, that cross is a stumbling block. They can't get around it. It's too wide. They can't get over it. It's too high. They can't tunnel under it. It's too low. And before you leave this planet or thereafter, you will come to a strategic inflection point face to face with the crucified Christ of Calvary, there to make a decision. I'm trying. To the Jews, religious folks, it's a stumbling block. And to the Greeks, you're going to love this one. Put this in parentheses. Here's what he's saying. The current culture. Stop wanting everybody to click like you. How many, what do they call them, friends or followers do you have? None. Do one thing they don't like. Make one statement outside of the parameters of their predetermined reality, which is not a reality at all, because reality must be based on absolute truth. So if you have your truth, her truth, their truth, here a truth, there a truth, everywhere a truthy truth, you don't have truth. You have facts. I wish I had half a church to preach to on Good Friday. You may have facts, but you don't have truth. A fact does not a truth make. John 17:17 in the gospel, Jesus said, Father, set my people apart by your truth. And then he tells you what it is. Your word is truth. The B-I-B-L-E. That's the book for me. I stand alone on the word of God, the B-I-B-L-E. It is the hinge upon which the door of all human history swings. It is the pivot round about which all the events of the ages rotate. It is the fulcrum of God's grand and glorious lever 4,000 years in the crafting. There, where one man on one tree on one Friday, pride, a fallen world, out of the unyielding hands of Satan's diabolical grasp. And if you want to get free tonight, ma'am, if you want to be loose tonight, sir, there is no other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved but the name of Jesus. I'm talking about his cross. His cross, rough and rugged, angry and mean. It's here, and here alone, at the intersection of two rough-hewn wooden beams, that we look with horrified wonder upon the raw ferocity of the love of God. Two beams. One stands vertical, reaching both to heaven and hell. One vertical, extending its arms and enveloping the entire world. This is the place where conviction joined hands with compassion, where truth went to the altar and married mercy, to reach the sinner and to transform the saint, to impact the culture, to redeem the world. The silence of the Lamb had ended. But the shout of the saints rings out. Alas, and did my Savior bleed? And did my sovereign die? Would he devote that sacred head for a sinner such as I? Was it for sins that I had done? He groaned upon the tree. Amazing pity, grace unknown, love beyond degree. At the cross, where in humility I first saw the light, where the burden of my sin-sick heart rolled away. It was there and there alone I received my sight. And now, when I don't have a dollar to change, and now, when they say they're gonna leave me and never be back, and now, when they tell me I've got vocal cord cancer and may never preach again, and now I'm happy all the day. Somebody give him praise, give him glory. This cosmic crossroads sits atop a skull-shaped hill near a garbage dump, just outside the walls of the capital of a troubled backwater province, on the periphery of the vast Roman Empire. Look now, on that center cross, here hangs the Son of God. Here dangles between heaven and earth the Prince of Heaven, alone, as abandoned as any human person has ever been or would ever be. The cross is the central theme and message of true Christianity. It is the irrefutable evidence of God's incandescent holiness and immeasurable love. It's the place where God's limitless provision runs headlong into our most basic human need, and where the furious love of God encounters broken and shattered hearts and people. There's no Christianity without the cross. It's the hallmark, here's that millennial word everybody loves so much, of an authentic, life-giving gospel. But in the 21st century of our world, in the United States of America, the cross has gone missing. We're a post-Christian culture. They scream at us. And the last thing anyone in polite society would ever do is offend the snowflakes and their delicate little sensibilities. I'm offended that you're offended, because where no offense is intended, none can be taken. But surely in our churches, surely there, we will find a bastion where the cross is treasured, where the cross is honored in its display and in its proclamation. If that were only the case. In a nation where a cross once
decorated the top of every steeple of every church from sea to shining sea. The cross has fallen quickly, undeniably, sharply out of fashion. I saw a news interview the other day. Someone was wearing a big cross. So they were asked by the interviewer, why do you wear the cross? I like it. Well, what does it represent to you? Now, there are many and varied answers. Salvation. Peace, hope, joy, strength, might, dominion, healing, redemption, salvation, eternal home, forgiveness, mercy, grace. Do you know what this person said? Represent. It's just jewelry. I wonder if that's what he thinks. Just jewelry. The cross scoffs a modern church. It's so old school. It's so churchy. The names on churches anymore. I saw one the other day said, not a church. No, it said, the church that's not a church. Crazy name. When did we become ashamed of who we are, of who he made us, of who he died, suffering, sighing, crying, and dying on that cross? We're afraid they won't like us. They don't like you anyway. And who cares if they like you? When he loves you. Why are you trying to please people? They all gonna die. The scene at Calvary, you understand, is simply too ugly. The implications of sin's toll and the severe demands of cosmic justice are just too troubling to ponder for very long. Oh, we got a lot of pastors eager to appease, to appease an image-conscious public. For them, placing a cross anywhere in prominence or ever mentioning it. I saw one that is putting out advertisement. Here's how we're going to get folks to come to church on Easter. When we invite them, these are words that must never be mentioned. The cross. The blood. Sacrifice. Eternity. Salvation. How many have we invited? Over 60,000 in 3 months, 20,000 a month. I dare you not to mention the blood. I dare you not to mention the price he paid to redeem a lost, depressed, depraved, dying, destitute world out of the unyielding clutches of Satan. I know I've gone too long. Folks weren't preaching like this to hurry. When I remember what he did for me on this day, I am in no way inclined to hurry. To those kind of preachers, the cross is just bad branding. I've been in those meetings. I've heard those words mentioned among God's people. If they can't get anything in here that they can't get out there, why do we bother? Crosses disappearing from our cities, from our landscapes, from our churches. But in a more troubling sense, it's we've been voluntarily removing it from our hearts, from our minds, silently, steadily, stealthily, without fanfare, without debate. We've slipped the cross of Christ out of our preaching, out of our singing, out of our programs, out of our children's ministry, out of our youth ministry, out of our young adult ministry. Well-intentioned efforts to reach America with the gospel of Christ have resulted in the prominence, hear this preacher, on this Good Friday, a crossless Christianity where sacrifice must never be mentioned. But it was there, right there on Golgotha's bloody brow, right there, where the living Christ was battered and bruised like never before and never since, has such love been on open display. They beat him with the Roman cat of nine tails until his flesh hang round about his legs. They beat his brow until it was swollen to the size of a bucket. They pierced his brow with a thorny crown and mockingly wrapped a purple robe around him. Words fail. I've tried. The intellect staggers and sputters. The heart beats question after question. The greatest of these questions: how could anyone do that for me? Richard Neuhouse said all the theories of atonement are but probings into the mystery of a love that did not have to be, but was and is. That great preacher of a former century, Charles Haddon Spurgeon, described it this way: come, believer, and contemplate this sublime truth proclaimed to each of us through seven simple monosyllables. He laid down his life for us. The ground shook. The source of all life trembled. The heart of all love burst wide open. You see, your life and mine don't make any sense unless and until, in the very depth of our being, we understand that Jesus loves us. And he pleads with us. Right now, tonight, around the world, he pleads with us to come. Come now, all you wounded, all of you frightened and angry and lonely and broken and bruised, and I will meet you where you are, not where you should be, because you're never going to be as you should be. So I have to ask you, do you really believe that? Do you really believe that Jesus Christ loves you? Not the person sitting in front of you, not the preacher, not Mahatma Gandhi, not Mother Teresa, but that he loves you beyond your worthiness. And in spite of your unworthiness, beyond your fidelity, and right in the middle of your infidelity, without caution, without regret, without boundary, without limitation, no matter what you've done or what you have not done, Jesus Christ has an issue. He simply cannot stop loving you. If you were God, you wouldn't love them. If they were God, they wouldn't love you. But that book says, God is not a man. Woo! This is the love of God expressed through the unspeakable, priceless gift of his Son, nailed by tempered spikes through tortured skin into splintered wood, bolted there, arms outstretched, asking, looking down through his blood-blurred vision, do I love you? Do I love you? Yes. Yes. A billion times. Yesterday, I love you today, and I will love you tomorrow, through every storm, through every tempest, through every raging wave. I loved you in life and living. I will love you in death and in dying. I will not leave you on earth without me. And I will not remain in heaven without you. Meet me. Meet me at this cross. And we will never, ever be separated again. I want you to get on your feet. And I want you to roar the greatest praise on Good Friday you have ever offered to the King of Glory, the Prince of Peace, the I Am that I Am, Jehovah Jesus Hakabah, the Lord strong and mighty, the Lord mighty in battle, Jesus of Nazareth, the King of Glory, the Lamb of God, slain from the foundation of the world. Everyone standing, no one moving. If you need to, for balance, just take hold of the seat in front of you. Every head bowed, every eye closed. Those of you watching around the world right now, quiet the place. Just a moment. Just a moment of reverence. For he who suffered beyond the gate, not for himself, but for you. Ponder, just in great brevity, this question. As you stand at the foot of that bloody beam, what will you do with Jesus? Here's the reality. The death toll among human persons remains at 100%. The book says it is appointed unto men once to die, and after that, the judgment. You do not commit. You are not a sinner because you commit sins. Banish the thought. You commit sins because you are a sinner, as we all are. But you can become as many millions around the world have, sinners saved by his grace. Not by our good works, by grace alone. Through faith, accepting Christ and the price he paid on that cross as the full propitiation, the full penalty paid in full for your sins and mine. And all he says to you now is, will you accept? Because he will not. People say, I would never serve a God who would send people to hell. I wouldn't either. But I serve a God who, though the penalty of hell was what I deserved, he did not give me justice. He gave me mercy. Mercy at the cross is great and grace is free. Pardon there was multiplied to me. There my sinful soul found liberty at Calvary. You can do that right now, right there where you are. You don't have to please anybody. You don't have to sign a paper. You don't have to make any kind of a commitment other than to the Christ who died for you. And now says, come unto me, and I'll forgive you, and I'll love you, and I'll make you a new person from the inside out, and I'll break the penalty and the curse of sin, and I will give you eternal life in heaven with me. I'm going to count to three. When I say three, you want to go to heaven and not hell. You want to serve God and not Satan. You want the love of Jesus Christ to be spread abroad in your heart. You want to pillow your head tonight as sure in your heart that you're on your way to heaven as if you were already there. You can be. You can go home tonight. You can be right there where you are at home, a brand new creature, a brand new mom, dad, son, daughter, auntie, uncle, grandma, grandpa. You can have peace that passes understanding in a troubled and whacked out world. You can know true north. His name is Jesus. Not religion, Jesus. Not a church, Jesus. He died for you. On three, you want to give your life to him who gave his life for you. When I say three, raise your hand. We're going to pray a prayer. If you're watching online, drop a one in the comments. Do it right now. Drop a one in the comments. We will send you literature. We will pray with you and for you. But if you're in one of these services streaming live right now, either in Columbus or Elkhart or one of our City Harvest Network churches around the world, when I say three, I want you to raise your hand bravely and boldly. We're going to pray. You're going to know grace and freedom and joy like you've never known. Do it right now. I'm counting. One. Hands are already going up. Two. This is it. 15 seconds between you and the choice to spend eternity with God or separated from Him. On three, raise that hand. Let's pray. Do it now. One, two, three. Raise that hand. God bless you. All over the building. My. Leave it up. Somebody's coming to give you some literature. Leave it up. Sing. Saints of God, leave that hand up. They're coming. Drop a one in those comments. We want to pray with you. We want to pray for you. Do it right now. Just drop a one. Sing, church. God, a great big shout of thank you.
Thank you, Lord. Thank
on
you,
this
Lord.
Good
thank
Friday.
You,
amazing you, grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. I was blind, but now I see. Woo! Well, thank you for letting me get a little preach on Good Friday. I know you got hams to bake and the like. Woo! You may be seated. 29 years ago. You stay with me right there where you are. 29 years ago, how many of you were not yet breathing air on God's green earth? You were not, that's what I thought. You make me feel so old. Ha. Huh. 29 years ago, I was 28 years old, 1985. Don't try to figure it out. There were two great things that came along in 1957. A 1957 Chevy Bel Air and me. It's staggering to me. 28 years old. I was sitting in my bachelor apartment. Can you say bachelor anymore? Is that a bad thing? I don't know. Like every third word I try to say, somebody's on the front row going. I won't tell you who asked. Anyway. That's young, you know? I didn't think it was so young then, 39 years ago. That was young. It was a year and a half before Miss Joni and I would stand before Dr. Sumrall and be joined in holy matrimony, where we still are. Say, I don't believe that. Well, don't worry, it'll never happen to you. But I was there, and I know the presence of God. And He came to me. I was studying. I was in my lazy boy recliner that was about 20 years old at the time, and my desk was a TV tray. It hadn't always been like this. God came to me. I was praying because we had grown so rapidly. We built a little 180-seat building, and then a year and a half later, we built, that was it. I didn't know you had that. Good job back there, Bradley, and all your cohorts. Look at those cars. Remember those vans? You don't remember those vans. What are you looking at? Those vans had shag carpet on the inside. Some of you don't even remember shag carpet, do you? It was the devil. Anyway, so we built that thing, and we were doing 7 services a week in there. And the place was overflowing. We tore the platform out, put folding chairs. We opened the little back foyer and put chairs in. And it was just so, year and a half after we started, with 17 people in my backyard and nothing. See, we had a cross on top of the steeple. And there was a bell in there. We rang it on Sunday morning. Little House on the Prairie. So we added on to it, and we made it 400 seats. We were in there about 2 years. Same thing, 7 services every week. And then we moved over here. That was the 1,200-seat building. That's where we were in 1984. 6 weeks after we were in there, we had to go back to all those services again. And you couldn't get in to any of them. And it was while we were in there that we needed an office building. Because, you know, the staff had grown. I don't know, there might have been 25, 30 of us at that time. And we needed an office building. But as so often is the case, we didn't have any money. So we hadn't borrowed any money at that point. And I didn't want to go to a bank and borrow money because we'd have still been paying for it. So I was in that little apartment and God came to me. And I said, God, I need this part right here to work for me. Now, I've been a tither all my life, but I need this right here to work. And prove me now herewith, says the Lord of hosts, that I will not open up the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing. There will not be room enough to receive it. But that came right after you've robbed me in tithe and offering. Now, he didn't say that I had robbed him, but he said this whole nation has robbed me in tithe and offering. He said to me, just as plainly as I'm talking to you right now, and I wrote it down 29 years ago, all year long, you tithe 10%. Well, I'd done that since I was 8 years old. Well, absolutely, that's what we do. That's what the tithe is. That's what your word says for us to do. So we do it. And we do it gladly and cheerfully because God refuses to do without a cheerful, ready-to-do-it giver. Hallelujah. Give, and it shall be given to you. Good measure, heaped up, pressed down, shaken together, running over, shall men give unto your bosom. The Lord Jesus takes pleasure in the prosperity of his servant. Excuse me while I quote the Bible to you. And God said, Easter's coming up, and this one time every year, now I didn't know at that time, I hate to admit it, I'd graduated from Bible college. I hate to tell you that nobody had ever taught me about Passover, Pentecost, and tabernacles. I didn't know that then. I'm sure you did, Elder Canfield. I didn't. You were one of my elders at that time. Looks like you'd have told me. I didn't know that. God said these 3 offerings you shall bring every year, and do not come empty-handed. Passover, that's Easter to you. Pentecost, 50 days later. and tabernacles in the fall of the year, three times a year, three offerings, the Bible says, of old, that shall continue in perpetuity forever. So I didn't know that then. So I told our little church, we need to build an office building. And the Holy Spirit has revealed to me that I am to challenge you. Now, when you're 28, you'll say anything. Look at these 22-year-olds think they know it all already. It's amazing how much less you know the older you get. It's what you learn after you know it all that counts. Anyway, so God said, you give 10%, that's the tithe. Yes. And he said, what about this offering? And he said, I want you to challenge the people not to give 10% that one time a year, but in celebration of me giving my only begotten son for their eternal salvation. I want you to challenge them to give their very best and see what I will do. And I said, okay. So I did. All three news, there were only three news people at that time. There wasn't a CNN and a Fox News. There wasn't all that. That's what I look like. You see what I mean? You think I'm not telling you about a miracle? People showing up listening to that. You couldn't get them in the doors. So I walked out there Easter Sunday morning. We had 7 weeks to gather our seed. And everybody went to gathering their seed. They did everything in the world. They had yard sales. They had bake sales. By the way, I want one of those. Where'd she go? Where's your wife? Oh, Princeton is healed in Jesus' name. Anyway, his wife is baking cakes for resurrection seed. You ought to buy one. Amen. I'm telling you what's the truth. She makes the best pound cake ever. Some pound cakes, you eat a piece, you gain a pound. Her pound cake, you eat a piece, you gain 10. I'm telling you, crispy on the outside and gooey on the inside. Right. I wish I had one right now. I deserve one, Jesus. Anyway, they did everything to gather their seed. And that Sunday morning, all three news, ABC, CBS, NBC, they all showed up, and they were at the altar. Not here, but in that 1,200-seat building. And I thought we got new cameras, but we didn't. It was them. And they started to leave midway through the song service. And I said, no, wait a minute. Hey. Come back in. Put them some chairs right there in the back. Because I want y'all to sit there and record for your news broadcast what you think God's not going to do. Because I said we're going to raise $100,000 that morning. Am I boring you? And take that down. That gives me the creeps. That looks like a toupee. Or a three-pay or a four, I don't know. Would you take that down? Thank you. Now, that's in the 1200s. No, that's in the 400 seat. That's not the right one either. There we go. That's the 1200 seat. And anyway, and how do I look in that one? Well, you can't really tell. That's good. There's Elder Canfield right there in that chair all the way to the right. That's Elder Canfield. And that's my sweet mother now gone to heaven over there. Praise God. And so we came out there, and I preached and gave the altar service, and they started to leave again. I said, no, don't go anywhere. And I told one of the ushers, I said, Well, it was, his name was Mark. I don't know if Mark's here tonight or not. Are you here, Mark? I know his wife's here. She's right there on that center camera where she's been for 40 years. He's in there. I told y'all to stay out of that room. Yeah. You were hiding on purpose. You didn't want everybody to see you lost all your hair. This is Mark. And I called Mark up just like I did that day, 39 years ago, right? And you came this way, and I said, Mark, go in there and tell them to bring me the total of that offering. The news is going to leave. Now, do I sound like I didn't have any faith? I mean, our average offerings at that time were $20,000. You're not in the building. A week from seven services. This is one. So I said, Mark, get in there and bring me this total. Go. So he went. He ran a little faster then. Stop, Mark. Come back out here where people can see you. Somebody give him a little powder for the top of his head. Hold on. All right. If he wasn't my friend, I wouldn't talk to him that way. Anyway, so he comes back in. I'm stretching. Preachers can always stretch. And I was stretching. And I said, come here, Mark, and show him what you did, Mark. How would you interpret that? My sister, the living God is my witness, was on the second row, and I saw her dive on the floor. I said, Debbie, what were you doing? She said, I was saying, God, let him lie. Let him lie. He can repent, but Jesus, it's going to be all over the city. Let him lie. She did. So I said, come here, Mark. What are you trying to tell me that we didn't make it?
The door's locked. I can't get in.
He said, the door's locked. And he's still here. Now that tells you how much mercy and grace I've got. He said, the door's locked. And standing right up there, I said, you go back through that door right there. You go back in there and kick the door down. So he started that way. But just about that time, here came a little white-haired lady. Her name was Mary Cunningham. This is 39 years ago. She had a little piece of white adding machine tape. We didn't have a computer. She's waving it. The white hair and glasses. She's waving it. I said, come here. And she put it down in front of me. And it wasn't 100,000. It wasn't 110 or 20 or 30 or 40. It was $142,000 cash that day. And they all three had to report it. Look what God did that nobody thought he would. There it is. And that's the foundation of that little building. So this is the time where we agree together in obedience to God's word. And those of us that God speaks to, we sow what we call a resurrection seed. And we believe God. Now, you can't buy a miracle. What kind of fool would think such a thing? If you could buy a miracle, the rich would own God, and we sure know they don't. I wish my tithe stays. Anyway, and we sowed. Now, we've done that for the last 39 years. And it's a season marked with the greatest miracles, breakthroughs we've ever seen. They handed me my son, who's back there working in the television control room right now. They handed me my son. I was preaching 120 nights a year on the road, 6 or 7 times a week here, daily television, daily radio. And we noticed that Austin wasn't responding to us. He was about 2.5, going on 3. He stopped eating. He would only eat 2 or 3 things. He would sit on the floor in the kitchen, and he would spin a little toy, and he would just watch it. Not for a few minutes, for hours. And we get behind him, and we shout his name. Just keep spinning. So I came home on a preaching trip, and we went to the Cleveland Clinic. Well, we thought maybe something was wrong with his ears. At that time, you hardly ever heard of autism spectrum disorders. You didn't hear that. And they examined our son. They came back in. There were 2 doctors. They came in with a third. And they said, now, this doctor is not for your son. He's for you. Because when we give most parents this news, they fall to pieces. Your son, you think I would ever forget, has a neurological disorder for which there is no treatment. I mean, they're rough. I mean, they want you to get it. You understand? There's no treatment. There is no cure. And there's no hope. I won't tell you what they said for parents in our condition, what most of them would do, but it wasn't pretty. They said he'll never go to school. He'll never read a book. He'll never know that you're his father and that you're his mother. And they handed me my son. And there I stood. What? Joan and I got in a rented van, and when I got onto the highway coming home, I pulled off to the side. Austin was in the seat behind us, strapped in, and he was asleep. My wife and I got down in the floor of that rented van, and we prayed. Some people say, well, when there's nothing else to do, pray. Prayer is the only thing to do, ever. And so we prayed. And I said, now listen, resurrection seed's coming up. And God's given me a figure, and I want to sow it. Will you agree with me? She said, of course I will. But when I gave her the number, she said, look, we don't, in everything we have, we couldn't put together 10% of that number. And I said, I'm telling you what God told me. You just agree with me. A couple weeks later, I had that entire seed in my hand because I refused not to have it. You say, well, how much was it? Well, what difference does it make? It's not the amount. It's the faith required to sow, to trust God. Because the book says, where your treasure is, that's where your heart is. Follow the money. So you can't argue with me. It won't work. Because my son is back there working right now. He graduated high school with a 4.0 average. He graduated college with a 4.0 average. And he's had the same girlfriend for 5 years, 6 years, whatever it is. Stand up, right there she is. And boy, does he know her name. Sit down. We love you, Sinead. And here's his sister that loves him like her mama does. Am I telling the truth? What are you looking at? Oh, yeah, he's acting crazy. He's about 6'3", an old man. He is in no way anything other than blessed. Blessed. Now that's my miracle. That's one. But don't you get tired of clapping for somebody else's miracle? Don't you think God's no respecter of persons? What he did for somebody, he'll do for you. That was my need, our need, our family's need. I don't know what you may need, but I know this. God always has delivered with a seed. If you don't believe it, I preached about it tonight. Jesus Christ was called the seed. He went away from heaven. A seed has to go away from you. He went into the earth and was covered over. But he sprang back to life. That's the nature of a seed. And it's the nature of a seed to reproduce. Woo! Some people say, well, I give to God and I don't expect anything in return. Well, I'll just believe for your return too. I mean, did you ever? We say these silly little, just so silly, Miss. It's so silly. What farmer sows a seed of corn and comes back and expects for a stalk to grow with one branch on it and one ear of corn, and you shuck it open and there's one kernel in there? That doesn't make any sense, does it? You plant an apple tree to get one apple? You plant an apple tree and hope you never get any apples? That's craziness. It's sure not God's word. So right now, we give you, all of you, because the Bible says all those that are partners with you in sowing and reaping receive the benefit as one born in the house. Isn't that something? So that's you. And we're believing God with you and for you. So on Good Friday night, we sow most of our resurrection seed. Some folks do on Easter, but most folks on Good Friday. Hallelujah. I want you to do your very best. Your very best. And I want you to believe God. Dr. Oral Roberts taught me when I was 22 years old, never sow a seed and not give it an assignment, something you're believing for. So let's do that right now. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for this prophetic revelation that you gave, this topos, this assignment that you gave this ministry 39 years ago. And we thank you for doing exactly what you said you'd do. And we have total and complete faith in you. We bless you. Amen. Amen. Everybody's got their phones out. You couldn't do that in 1985. It didn't work. Amen. Hold on, guys. You're in a hurry. I got all these people getting ready. Amen. Hallelujah. Well, if I could sing, I would. I can sing. You just not might not enjoy it. Amen. All right, go ahead. Go ahead. If the containers come to you and you're not ready, just hold the container till you get ready. Amen. Easter Sunday morning, my great, great God. I wish it was in 5 minutes. Amen. I'm going to bring a message for you on Easter that all your family and all your friends will just love. It's about just 3 days. What can happen in just 3 days? Amen. Elder Canfield is coming. By the way, we finally, thank you to whoever got something done I've been trying to do for about 8 years. We did get his beautiful name on the hall that bears his name at Valor Christian College, Canfield Hall. We love you so much. And Miss Paula, too, is doing great, recovering well, healed in Jesus' name. Because we want to receive Holy Communion. So get your elements ready. Amen? Are you ready, sir? Well, the floor is yours.
Do you appreciate our pastor, Dr. Rod Parsley, and everything that he does for us, especially during resurrection season? Hallelujah. We're giving the ushers an opportunity to receive your offering. And those of you who don't have communion elements, we're going to give you just a moment to get yours and get them ready. They got them packaged in this convenient little package here, but sometimes our technology exceeds our ability, and we can't peel the little cellophane wrapper off the top of it. So I'll give you just a moment to get that taken care of, because you got to get the cellophane off to get at the bread that's in there, and then the foil wrapper comes off to get at the juice that's underneath that. Do want you to use caution as you manipulate these little cups, because we do have new carpet in here, and we want to keep it looking new. Amen. Praise God. But what it is that you're about to partake of are symbols. They're symbols. Symbols of something. Let me just read you the definition here. I got it written down so I wouldn't forget it. A symbol is defined as a thing that represents or stands for something else, especially a material object representing something abstract. These elements that you hold in your hand are symbols. They're material things that represent something abstract. Somebody said, well, I'm not sure I see how that relates to what it is that we're doing here on Resurrection Weekend. Well, let me just put it to you this way. When you want to let somebody know that you remember them, that you're thinking of them, that you love them, you give them symbols. We call them letters gathered together into words and sentences and paragraphs. And you may put it in a text. You may put it in an email. You may go old school and handwrite a letter that you send by snail mail. And those are symbols, but they represent something else. They represent your love, your care, your concern, your affirmation. And tonight, my brother and sister, God has given us symbols. They represent that He remembers us, that He's thinking of us, that He loves us. And these symbols that we're about to partake of represent something abstract. That wafer that you have there in the top of that little cup represents the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, which itself represents our healing for our physical, natural bodies. Praise God. God provided that for us. That juice in that cup is a symbol that represents the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. Thank God the blood represents the forgiveness of sins that we have as a result of the sacrifice that Christ made. Praise God. Praise God. And so, there's no better time for us to celebrate what it is that Christ has already done for us than on Good Friday, partaking together with our brothers and sisters in the Lord. And we're going to receive, and we're going to thank God, and we're going to celebrate together. Now, if there's anybody who has not been served with these elements yet, I want to make sure that you have an opportunity to get served. If you have not been served, raise your hand, and somebody will give you this cup and make sure that we can all partake together. Hallelujah. Looks like just about everybody has been served. Here's what the Word of God says. The Lord Jesus, the night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had broken it, he said, "This bread is my body that's been broken for you. Take it and eat it in remembrance of me." Let's partake of the bread together. The Bible says, after the same manner also, he took the cup when he had supped, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. This do as oft as you drink it in remembrance of me." Let's partake of the cup together. Now let the next thing that comes out of your mouth be a hallelujah in celebration of what the Lord Jesus Christ has already done for us and the victory that we've achieved as a result of what he's done. Come on, let's stand and bless him. Let's stand and worship him. Let's stand and celebrate the freedom that we enjoy as a result of what Christ has already done for us.
Let grateful people send up one more thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. We're so glad that you came to be with us tonight or wherever you're joining us from. Hey, if you're a first-time guest of ours tonight, it's your first time here with us or first time in a long time, we want to connect with you. Here's how you can help us do that right there at your seat. If you'll take just a moment and fill out that card, then as you leave tonight in any of our foyers, you're going to see these new here stations. Drop the card off there and get a special gift from our pastor right to you. Well, listen, as you exit tonight, don't forget to pick up your kiddos. They've had an amazing time as they've done the walk through the Bible and the story of Resurrection Weekend has come to life. Get them, and we'll see you right back here, Resurrection Easter Sunday morning with your one. God bless you. Happy Good Friday.
Sowing into the kingdom of God has never been easier or more secure than with Smart Giving. Any smartphone will work. To use your Smart Giving, open your text messaging app and send a message to number 45777. In the message of your text, type the amount of your gift, space WHC. If it's your first time giving, you'll receive a secure link to set up your account. Select your home campus, enter your giving method, and where you would like to receive your instant giving receipt. If you already registered, the process is the same. Just send a text message to 45777. Type the amount of your gift, space WHC. You'll receive your receipt immediately. If you prefer, you can also sow online at whc.life or by phone or mail. Just call the number on your screen or send your gift to the address displayed.
Oh, in sin and clothed in death, mercy was my plea. Love compelled the heart of God to send grace down to me. Lost in sin, a wretched soul, desperate to be free. Oh, precious one, God's only Son, grace went to Calvary. Grace, powerful grace, grace that restores and rescues me. Grace, powerful grace, I sing the song of the redeemed.